welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, John Russell and I have a story on how artificial intelligence might, or might not, reduce the number of jobs. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's science report. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
ChatGPT and other generative AI tools have raised concerns that chatbots will replace many kinds of workers. Writers, editors, and customer service representatives are among the jobs that could be affected. But some people are suggesting that AI might not reduce jobs as many people fear. Instead, the technology might turn out to be more like the technological developments of the past, such as the steam engine, electricity, or the internet. Supporters reason that AI might destroy some jobs while creating others. They also say that the technology will probably make workers more productive, benefiting themselves, their employers, and the economy.
Nick Bunker is an economist at the Indeed Hiring Lab, part of a job search website. He said he thinks AI will affect many, many jobs, maybe every job indirectly, to some degree. Bunker added that he does not believe the technology is going to lead to a lot of unemployment. We have seen other big technological events in our history, and those didn't lead to a large rise in unemployment. Technology destroys, but also creates. There will be new jobs that come about, he said. Artificial intelligence gives machines the ability to perform tasks once thought to require human intelligence. The basic technology has existed in early versions for many years. Some reports say it began with a problem-solving computer program called Logic Theorist. The program was developed in the 1950s at what is now Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. More recent examples include voice assistants like Apple's Siri, Amazon's Alexa, or IBM's chess-playing computer Deep Blue, which defeated then-world champion Garry Kasparov in 1997.
Sam Altman is the chief of OpenAI, the creator of ChatGPT. Altman said in a discussion at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, or MIT, in May, that he believes AI is going to eliminate a lot of current jobs, and this is going to change the way that a lot of current jobs function. Some people say that AI chatbots are not replacing human workers in a widespread way. Challenger, Gray, and Christmas, a company that tracks job cuts, said it has yet to see much evidence of job losses caused by AI. However, the fear that AI is a threat to some kinds of jobs has a basis in reality. Sumit Shah is an Indian business owner who announced last year that he had replaced 90% of his customer support workers with a chatbot named Lena. Shah's company, Dukan, helped customers set up e-commerce sites to sell goods online. Shaw said the average amount of time it took to answer a customer's question shrank from 1 minute, 44 seconds, to instant. The chatbot also cut the time needed to resolve problems from more than 2 hours to just over 3 minutes. A 2023 study by researchers at Princeton University, the University of Pennsylvania, and New York University identified jobs most exposed to AI models. The jobs included telemarketers and teachers of English and foreign languages. But being affected by AI does not necessarily mean losing your job to it. AI can free people to do more creative jobs. The Swedish company IKEA introduced a customer service chatbot in 2021 to deal with simple questions. Instead of cutting jobs, IKEA kept 8,500 customer service workers to advise buyers on interior design and to deal with complex customer calls. Chatbots can also make workers more efficient. Eric Brynjolfsson of Stanford University, Danielle Lee, and Lindsay Raymond of MIT studied 5,200 customer support agents at a large company. The agents used a generative AI-based assistant. The AI tool provided valuable suggestions. It also supplied links to useful company documents. The researchers found that those who used the chatbot were 14% more productive than workers who did not use the chatbot. The workers who used AI took more calls and completed them faster. The biggest productivity gains, 34%, came from the least experienced, least skilled workers. Alorica is a company in Irvine, California, that runs customer service centers around the world. The company has introduced an artificial intelligence translation tool that lets its representatives communicate with customers who speak any of 200 different languages and 75 dialects. The real-time voice language translation tool also lets customers and Alorica agents speak and hear each other in their own languages. It allows Alorica reps to handle every call they get, said Rene Pais, a vice president of customer service. Pais added, "I don't have to hire externally just to find someone who speaks a specific language." Alorica said it is not cutting jobs. It continues to seek new employees who are comfortable with new technology. "We are still actively hiring," Pais says. "We have a lot that needs to be done out there." I'm John Russell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
The American Space Agency, NASA, says it has confirmed the long-suspected existence of an electric field that surrounds Earth. A rocket named Endurance gathered the information that led to the confirmation. Endurance launched from Norway on May 11, 2022. The launch site was the closest possible to the North Pole. Endurance reached a top altitude of 768 kilometers. The rocket captured data on the electric field during its 19-minute flight before splashing down in the sea off the coast of Greenland. NASA says that since the 1960s, spacecraft flying over Earth's poles have recorded collections of particles flowing from the planet's atmosphere into space. but the cause of these outflows long remained a mystery. Scientists lacked the technology and tools to confirm an electric field and further explore it. But the development in recent years of new observation methods and instruments led NASA to plan the Endurance mission. So the agency built the rocket and a new data instrument and planned the launch. NASA scientist Glenn Collinson, an expert in space instrument design, led the Endurance mission. Collinson explains in a video that scientists believe the electric field they searched for was one of three energy fields affecting Earth. The others are gravitational and magnetic. Scientists are calling the third energy field the ambipolar electric field. A NASA statement says scientists believe the ambipolar field is an influential driver of the polar wind. They described the wind as a steady outflow of charged particles into space that occurs above Earth's poles. Scientists believe the ambipolar electric field counteracts some of the effects of gravity. This electric field lifts the charged particles in Earth's upper atmosphere to greater heights than they would otherwise reach, NASA said. Scientists had theorized this electric field began at around 250 kilometers high. This is where atoms in our atmosphere break apart into negatively charged electrons and positively charged ions. This activity helps form a part of Earth's atmosphere known as the ionosphere. NASA noted the Endurance mission permitted researchers to successfully identify and measure a planet-wide electric field thought to be as fundamental to Earth as its gravity and magnetic fields. A study describing the team's results recently appeared in the publication Nature. NASA said studying the ambipolar electric field is important because it may have shaped our planet's evolution in ways yet to be explored. In addition, the agency said further study of this field can help scientists better understand other planets and possibly find ones with conditions that may support life. Leader Collinson said that during the mission, the instrument on the rocket was able to measure an electrical voltage of 0.55 volts. He said this level is very low, about the same voltage used to power a watch battery. But he noted that 0.55 volts was just the right amount to explain the outflows of particles driving the polar wind. Collinson said he finds the results incredibly important because the newly confirmed electric field can counter the effects of gravity and basically lifts the skies up. He described the field as a kind of conveyor belt that's lifting this atmosphere up into space. Alex Gloser is a project scientist for the Endurance mission and was a co-writer of the study. He said he agrees with those findings. That's more than enough to counter gravity. In fact, it's enough to launch them upwards into space at supersonic speeds, Gloser said. Supersonic describes speeds that are greater than the speed of sound. The team said the study results suggest the ambipolar electric field also greatly increases the density of the ionosphere at higher atmospheric positions. Collinson said, any planet with an atmosphere should have an ambipolar field. Now that we've finally measured it, we can begin learning how it's shaped our planet, as well as others, over time. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Now, Bryan Lynn joins me to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week's report was about a space mission NASA says confirmed the existence of a hidden electric field surrounding Earth. Scientists had long suspected this field existed, but do we know why it took so long for the confirmation to happen?
Yes, actually, there are a couple of reasons for this. As mentioned in the report, the leader of this mission, Glenn Collinson, said the main reason it took so long was that scientists didn't have the right technology and data collection methods to make a solid confirmation. So he and his team set out to design a special instrument to measure this electric field, and the team's work was helped by observations and research on other planets. For example, a previous project discovered new details about a powerful electric field that influences the planet Venus.
What does the discovery mean for the team's research moving forward?
So NASA scientists have said that even though they were able to successfully measure this electric field this time, it still leaves many unanswered questions. For example, Collinson said his team's future research will center on studies of how this field might have affected the development of Earth and even how it might have influenced our oceans. And he added it may help scientists better understand the development of other planets as well.
All right. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
My name is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Being in Washington gives Anna the opportunity to meet people from all over the world. And she likes that a lot.
Or as she would say, she thinks that's awesome.
Anna thinks a lot of things are awesome. She is a very enthusiastic person.
If you're enthusiastic, it means you have a lot of positive feelings and energy about something.
She's quite enthusiastic. To her, it's so fantastic. Living in the capital known as D.C.
Well, thanks for that little jingle, Andrew.
Well, maybe it will help people remember the words enthusiastic and fantastic.
Maybe. So, as we were saying, Anna likes to meet people from different parts of the world. And in Lesson 16, she is excited.
This is very exciting.
Excuse me. As I was saying, Anna is excited because she gets to interview tourists who are visiting Washington, D.C. Let's listen to her first interview.
Hello. Washington, D.C. has many tourists. People from different countries come here. Today, my job is to interview tourists. I have to learn why they come here. This is very exciting.
Excuse me,
I'm Anna Mateo from The News. Do you have time for an interview?
Sure, I have time.
What is your name?
My name is Sabrina.
What country are you from?
I'm from Bangladesh.
So you are Bangladeshi?
That's right. My nationality is Bangladeshi.
Do you like Washington, D.C.?
Yes, the city is very beautiful.
What do you like to do in Washington, D.C.?
I like history, so I like walking around and looking at all the monuments and memorials. They make history come alive.
Washington has many monuments and memorials. The Washington Monument is behind us. Which is your favorite?
I really like Lincoln Memorial. It is very beautiful, and it feels like Abraham Lincoln is still alive.
Awesome. Thank you for your time, Sabrina.
You're welcome.
Visiting the monuments and memorials in D.C. is also important to many Americans. And you'll notice that the word memorial sounds similar to the word memory.
That's because the two words share the same root, the Latin word memoria. And a memorial is something that pays respect to the memory of the lives of people who have died. Washington, D.C. has memorials to presidents, such as Abraham Lincoln and Thomas Jefferson, to the civil rights leader, Martin Luther King Jr., and to soldiers who have fought in wars. Examples of these are the Vietnam Memorial and the World War II Memorial.
Memorials can be inspiring, but also somber at the same time.
That's right. Somber means serious or sad.
And when we talk about the monuments in Washington, most of those include the memorials. A monument is a large structure, usually made out of stone, built to remind people of a famous person or a famous historical event.
And the adjective monumental means very large or very important.
So, for example, we can say that the Apollo moon landings were a monumental achievement.
And Anna would probably say the moon landings were awesome.
And I think she's right. They were pretty amazing. Speaking of Anna, I noticed something she said pretty quickly when she was interviewing tourists. She used the common expression, a couple of.
In English, the exact meaning of a couple is two of anything. So if you want a couple of apples, that means you want two apples. But native speakers are not always so exact. When they say a couple of, they just mean a few or a small number.
Let's listen to Anna say that. We'll listen a couple of times. In this case, exactly two.
Oh, excuse me. I am Anna Mateo from The News. Do you have time for a couple of questions? Hello, I am Anna Mateo from The News. Do you have time to answer a couple of questions?
A couple of is one of those expressions native speakers usually say quickly. Instead of saying of, we just say because it's quicker. Lesson 16 of Let's Learn English has a pronunciation video that helps you practice this. Let's listen.
When English speakers use the expression a couple of to talk about two things, they often say of quickly. It sounds like a couple. Listen to Anna ask a tourist to answer a couple of questions.
Oh, excuse me. I am Anna Mateo from The News. Do you have time for a couple of questions?
I noticed another thing Anna said when she asked tourists for an interview. We're going to listen to a couple of examples.
Oh, excuse me. I am Anna Mateo from The News. Do you have time for a couple of questions? Hello, I am Anna Mateo from the news. Do you have time to answer a couple of questions?
You'll notice that in the first example, Anna said each of the three words, do you have, clearly. Anna started speaking more quickly in the second example. You can still hear each of the three words, but the words do you sound like one word, do you?
Do you have time to answer a couple of questions?
And what would happen if Anna started speaking even faster? Do you have is such a common and short phrase that native speakers usually say it very quickly, like this, do you have? The word you becomes reduced to the sound ya. So it sounds like this, do you have?
I think this might be easy and fun for our listeners to practice saying quickly. Listen first to Jill and me as we ask and answer questions. Then we'll give you a chance to listen and repeat.
Do you have it?
I don't have it.
Do you want it?
I don't want it.
Do you need it?
I don't need it.
Do you know it?
I don't know it.
Do you see it?
I don't see it.
Do you have to?
I don't have to.
Do you like it?
I don't like it.
Do you mean it?
I don't mean it.
Now, listen just to the question and then repeat it with your own voice.
Do you have it? Do you want it? Do you need it? Do you know it? Do you see it? Do you feel it? Do you have to? Do you like it? Do you mean it? Good job, listeners. You've probably noticed that if you want to sound more like a native speaker, you have to learn to put small words together quickly and not say each vowel sound the way you do when you are speaking slowly.
Do you want to repeat some of those phrases one more time?
Sure. Listen to me say these phrases quickly. And if you have something to write with, try to jot down what I'm saying.
Jot down means to write quickly. Jot is spelled J-O-T.
Okay. I'm going to count to three and then say them quickly. Listeners, are you ready? One, two, three. Do you have it? Do you want it? Do you need it? Do you know it? Do you see it? Do you feel it? Do you have to? Do you like it? Do you mean it?
I think that list is too fast to jot down all at once, but don't worry, you can go back and listen again. Andrew, I noticed that when you read the list quickly, it had an even beat, almost like music.
That's right. And listening to the rhythm of English can be helpful for learning how to pronounce it well. So you can clap your hands while you listen, like this. Do you have it? Do you want it? Do you need it? Do you know it? Do you see it? Do you feel it? Do you have to? Do you like it? Do you mean it?
Keep listening for the ways native speakers say small words and short phrases quickly. And then try to imitate what you hear. You can find many useful examples in Let's Learn English and other VOA programs. And thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.